Louisiana Legends is made possible by Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Louisiana. This important program series enables us to discover, through the accomplishments of our fellow Louisianians, the unique character of a state so proudly served by Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Louisiana for 60 years.
I want to describe my guest in an official manner, though there's nothing official about her. She's a very warm, lovely lady. Try on First Lady of American Restaurants and this country's most successful woman restaurateur. She's the dynamic, sweet, and obviously genius, Ruth Fertel, the founder and CEO of Ruth's Chris Steakhouse. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Oh, thank you, Gus. It's nice to have be here.
Thank you, ma'am. Ruth, it started for you. You were born in New Orleans.
Yes, I was.
And then you said your folks moved over to Plaquemines Parish.
Yes, my mother was from Plaquemines Parish, and Dad had been living down there for quite a few years. He was farming at the time. He loved farming. And when they married, they moved to New Orleans. He got a job as selling insurance, so moved to New Orleans. And then, after about 7-8 years, they were able to give him a route down in Plaquemines Parish. They wanted to go back there because that's where Mom was from and Dad had lived there for years. So from when I was five years old, we moved down to Plaquemines Parish. And that's where I went to. It was my growing up years, where I spent my childhood.
Now, Ruth, when you were a young woman, high school and even college, which we'll go into in a moment, you had no interest in foods, did you particularly? Did you enjoy cooking?
Well, I tell you what, my mom and grandmother were the most wonderful cooks.
Oh, were they?
Okay. You know, Creole cooking.
Yes, ma'am.
And not steaks, however. And so I was used to wonderful food, but as I say, not steaks.
Now, folks, at least we think this is a simple lady. I've got to tell you what her degrees were at LSU. And I think this is going to come as a shock to a lot of folks. Let's see, where are we? Oh, yeah. You earned a degree in chemistry.
Yes.
With a minor in physics.
Yes.
At LSU.
Yes.
Was that your passion, chemistry and physics?
Actually, I was really good in math and always loved math, and that was, I did really well in chemistry, and the dean of chemistry and physics, who was Dr. Chopin at that time, talked me into coming into that college, and so I did and graduated from the College of Chemistry and Physics.
You left something out. You graduated at age 19.
Yes, I did.
How did you do that? It took me, I think, a lifetime to get out of there.
Well, in the olden days, when I was going to school, they didn't have 12 grades. First of all, they had 11. And I started school when I was 5, and it was in a one-room schoolhouse with 5 grades. So after I had my lessons in the first grade, the second, third, fourth, and fifth would have their lessons, so I learned all of that, so skipped the second grade.
You must have had a pretty good math teacher, though, to turn you on to it and inspire you. Or you were just a natural?
I think mm-hmm. I was just naturally good in math. I just loved it.
Now, another little fact that a lot of folks may be surprised at, you actually taught briefly at McNeese State University.
Yes, I did.
It was then McNeese College.
It was in McNeese
Lake
Junior College,
Junior
right,
College
yes.
in Lake Charles.
Yes, now I
did
think it's
did you enjoy that?
Not really. No, I didn't really like teaching. And I think I stayed a semester in a summer school. I started in February. And I think I started the day after my 20th birthday. So I was... In those days, this was in 1947, excuse me, and most of my students were veterans, so they were all older than I was. Most of them, 90% of them, 95% were there to learn. but they had a few jokers in the class that made my life miserable, and so I lasted just
with this young, good-looking teacher. I can imagine, of course, sure. These guys are right out of the war.
It was absolutely miserable for me, so I didn't last too long.
Ruth, you got married.
Yes,
and
I did.
14 years later, you were divorced.
Actually, a little shorter than that. It was 10. But go ahead.
And you worked as a lab technician at the Tulane Medical Center.
Yes, I did. And I like that job, by the way.
But not enough to stay.
Well, I wasn't making enough money. My boys were getting older, and I knew they were going to want to go to college. And
so tell us that wonderful story. This young lady working at Tulane, and she's got two sons and wants to send them to college. So you're reading the want ads, huh?
Well, yes, while I was working, and I think I had worked for Tulane for about 4 or 5 years and I needed more money. So I started looking. You know, where do you look to buy a business? I thought if I would own my own business, I could surely make more money than I was making.
But you didn't have the money to buy a business, did you?
No, but I did have a home. I'd gotten my home mortgage free from the divorce. So
yes,
that
ma'am.
Was all I actually had. So I continued to look in the business personals and business opportunities in the daily newspaper, the Times-Picayune. And finally, they had a lot of service stations and bars and saloons. And I finally saw this one little ad that said steakhouse for sale with the phone number. And that I said, oh, I can do that. And so I went to see it, and it was Chris Steakhouse. And I asked him how much he wanted, Mr. Chris, I called him. He was retiring. I think he was 65. And he said $18,000, and I said, I'll buy it. So I went to my bank and mortgaged my home, and I was in business in about 2 or 3 weeks.
But your banker said 18 is not enough.
Well, he did say, thank God for my banker. He insisted I borrow $4,000 more for supplies and food, you know, to keep going.
So that gives you an idea how much you knew.
Oh, I was so naive about business. I really was.
Ruth, so you open this steakhouse, and initially it doesn't do all that great, does it?
No, actually, the first month I was in business, I averaged 35 steaks a day, so it wasn't really, and in those days, steaks were $5, so I wasn't taking in a lot of money. But about 5 months after I bought the place, it was starting to gradually increase, but the latter part of September, early October, Betsy came along. And, I was closed down for a week and almost lost all of my meat. And so I cooked it all up and sent it down to Plaquemines Parish. My heart still belonged in Plaquemines Parish. And when I reopened a week later and had gotten more meat in, all the construction crews and the telephone company, utility companies, were all out in force getting New Orleans back together because everyone had been without telephones and electricity and gas for quite a while. So at that time, too, the bishop gave a special dispensation that you could eat meat on Friday. So I'd started opening at that time
on
Friday.
So even God smiled
on you. From something bad, something good always comes. It really does.
Now, to you folks who say, well, I wouldn't make a move like Ruth made mortgaging that house, which was really all she had, without talking to my lawyer, my banker, my friends. Well, Ruth Fertel did, and what was their advice about
buying? They told me I was absolutely crazy.
Don't do it. So much
don't
for the
do
advice.
It. You will lose your house.
So much for the advice of
yes,
experts.
Yes.
So, Ruth, you have this business. And when did you begin calling it Ruth's Chris Steakhouse?
When I had bought Chris Steakhouse, I could only use, in the act of sale, was this little caveat that said I could only use the name while I was in that location. When I opened a second Chris Steakhouse in New Orleans before my lease was up, Mr. Chris had taken me to court, and he lost, of course, because I was still in that location. But about 10 years after, I had just signed a new lease because I was doing really well. I had a fire and had to move.
Oh.
And so I moved, I bought a building just four blocks down the street, and in a week I was open again, but I knew I couldn't call it Chris Steakhouse because I wasn't in the old location.
Yes, ma'am.
So I just added, it was such a short period of time, I just added my name. No marketing study, and it just became Ruth's Chris Steakhouse.
Wow, let me ask you, after you begin to get involved in this restaurant business, and you had two at the time, what was your vision of a restaurant? What did you want Ruth's Chris Steakhouse to be? And you have the kind of mind that, that would think about those
things.
Well,
all I wanted to do was do more business to grow. And of course, when it became so busy that people were leaving, it was a very small restaurant, a 60-seat restaurant. They would leave because they would have a long wait. That's when I opened my second one. And when still the business kept increasing, I bought a third one, and that was out on Veterans, which is still open. But I never dreamed, I just get antsy doing the same thing over and over. So my deal is I just love to grow. And after I'd moved to the, had the fire and moved down the street, that's when T.J. Moran from Baton Rouge came in and wanted, he said, I am getting so tired of every time I want a good steak driving to New Orleans, you've got to let me open one in Baton Rouge. And at first I refused, and he kept coming back and again and again, so
he's
finally.
He's a pretty bright man himself.
Yes, he is. He's a tremendous man. And now, in fact, he has seven Ruth's Chris Steakhouses.
All over the place.
All over the place, yes.
Ruth, what makes... And I don't think that I'm giving you a free advertisement. Everybody acknowledges this. What makes your steaks so terrific?
Well, first of all, we start with prime meat.
Yes, ma'am.
And that prime meat comes from the corn country, which I think gives the meat its wonderful flavor. And we simply salt and pepper it and broil it, and then put a little butter on it after it's cooked on a hot plate so it stays hot from first to the last bite.
And how about those recipes for your vegetables, like your lion-eyed potatoes and your salad dressings? I love the French dressing. My wife, Leanne, likes your blue cheese.
Yes. The French dressing is the only dressing that I got from Mr. Chris. All of the others, I did. And the menu grew in the beginning. I hardly had, well, very few vegetables. I think we had three potatoes and no vegetables, and the four steaks, the filet, ribeye, strip, the New York strip, and the porterhouse. And my customers wanted, why don't you do broccoli, cauliflower, whatever, do some
I
vegetables.
Like the gratin, some like
yeah.
Broccoli.
And so I started doing recipes to accommodate my customers. That's what they wanted, so that's what I gave
them. How about that cream spinach? You can see I'm a true fan.
Cream spinach is one of the most popular dishes that we have, and I did it.
Now, how many Ruth's Chris Steakhouses are there in 1998?
There are 65, and seven of them are out of the country. We have two in Taiwan, Taipei and Taichung. We just opened one in Hong Kong in November. We have one in Toronto, two in Mexico, Mexico City and Cancun, and one in Puerto Rico.
So how many steaks do you think Ruth's Chris are cooking a day?
It's about 12,000 a day now.
My goodness sakes.
Yeah,
about 12,000. And how many employees?
Between 4,000 and 5,000. We have 24 company-owned restaurants, and the balance are 41 are franchisees. So we all have about 70 to 80 people in each restaurant. So it's about 5,000.
You said that it gave you so much pleasure to know that you were putting a lot of folks, a lot of families, a good livelihood.
Yes, that is really very gratifying that you know I'm helping so many people. And they all enjoy their work. They love working for Ruth's Chris, and I think it's because they get more compliments than complaints.
Now,
it's a nice atmosphere to work.
Very. Now, I wanted to ask you, Do many of your waiters, people who start out on the wait staff, end up managers? In other words, have you seen people go up in the business?
Oh, absolutely. In fact, I had the first three waitresses I started with, I had three women working for me. They all eventually managed one of the restaurants.
Really?
And one is retired and two died, I think.
How do you, what controls do you have to maintain your standards, for example, among your franchisees?
Well, I have wonderful, wonderful people working for me. And I've always tried to hire people that know so much more than I do. And I've learned a lot from the people that I've hired. And now we have people that go around to all the franchise and the company stores constantly.
Unannounced,
yes. And announced both, and checking on the food and the service and the cleanliness, the whole ball of wax, so to speak.
Do you ever have to send out word that you're dissatisfied with this or is there any hesitancy when you do?
Oh, no.
No.
No. You have to. You know, consistency is the name of the game, and a lot of chefs like to add their own little 2 cents into recipes, and
yes.
That is really, that's not too good.
Ruth, and this is a question I know you've been asked 5,000 times, so bear with us. To what do you attribute your success?
I think it's the consistency of the food and also the wonderful flavor of that prime beef.
You said in a statement that it's as simple as, I'm going to quote you, as following the golden rule. I treat my customers and my associates as I would want to be treated.
I live that every day, too. And I think that's a big reason why I grew, because whatever the customer wanted, if I had it in the restaurant and they wanted it, I would fix it any way they wanted it. And it was just trying to please the customers. I treated them as if they were in my home. And
you told me that last year you overdid it. You visited so many of your restaurants.
Oh, gosh, I visited 42 restaurants, and that was a little more than I ever want to do again, to tell you the truth.
Ruth, is there any possibility that company, your company, will ever go public?
Well, it's a possibility.
I'd like some stock is the reason I'm asking.
Well, the reason it's always, everything's a possibility. The reason, though, that we have not gone public so far is because I'm very interested in growth, but we've been growing. And by the way, I have stopped franchising. The franchisees can only open in their own territory. So we want to grow corporately, and we have been able to, out of the profits, to be able to open. So we don't really need to go public right now.
But someday that's down the line.
It could be, you know.
May I ask what corporate sales are a year, if that's not a fair question?
Last year in 1997, it was $217 million. The year before was $176 million. So we had, like last year, like a little over 23% growth. This year, it looks like it might be $235, $240 million.
It's growing up.
It is growing.
Yeah, but business is good in America, isn't it?
Business has been wonderful last year and this year. The economy is fabulous, and it shows.
Give some advice, if you will, to some person out there who perhaps is widowed or divorced or not, who's not satisfied with what they're doing, who need more money, as you did. What can you do now? Could someone do now what you did?
I probably with a little more money, but yes. But you know, I was so lucky that I fell into something that I really, really love. And I think that if you ever go into business, you better find something you really love, because you spend so many hours with it. It almost becomes your life. And but you have to also have a product that people want and need.
I want to ask you, you told me that either last night or the night before you went to one of your restaurants and had a steak.
Yes.
Now tell us, what's the perfect meal for Ruth Fertel? What do you enjoy ordering? What vegetable salad and so on?
Well, I love the sliced tomato and onion with the blue cheese and vinaigrette dressing. I really love it, and especially right now with the Creole tomatoes in and the Vidalia onions. It is wonderful. Then I always get a New York strip. I just love the New York strip.
Cooked how? Medium?
Medium rare.
Medium rare.
And charred a bit. And the cream spinach, and that's
the
about my meal.
Are you a pretty good tipper?
Oh, yeah, I tip pretty good. They would really talk about me if I didn't.
Ruth, how do you enjoy eating in other people's restaurants?
Oh, I do enjoy it. However, I remember I have to find a friend who wants to go out. I don't like to eat alone.
Of course not.
And so I just eat at home a lot. But I do love to eat out. My son, Randy, loves to eat out, too. So we make a pair every now and then to go to all the different restaurants.
You've got some grandsons.
Yes, I have five grandsons.
Five. And you told me that at least a couple of them are in Lafayette. Is that
yes.
correct?
Yes. Uh-huh.
And I would like you to tell folks, they're in the restaurant business, folks. They're starting out, and I want Ruth to tell you what they do.
They're in high school, and they're busing for the summer to make a little extra money.
You told me that you love Lafayette. If you did not live in New Orleans, you would live
and
there.
And I would
That's
never
my
move
hometown.
From Lafayette, but I do love, I would never move from New Orleans, but I do love Lafayette. The people there are so friendly.
They
never meet a stranger.
Mm-hmm.
And
pretty good cooks, too.
Oh, and they're wonderful cooks. They really are.
You know, you and I were talking. You were telling me about the success there in Lafayette with your restaurant and so on. And that seemed very logical to me. And I replied, as a native Lafayette person, that's all we did was talk about food, cook food, and eat food.
Where are you going to eat tomorrow night?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Even as you're eating, particularly in one of those camps, in St. Martin Parish, for example.
Yeah.
As you're eating, they're talking about what tomorrow night somebody's going to have, leg of lamb.
That's right. But Lafayette, we would never go in, I don't think, in a small market like that again. But at the time, I had a very big oil field industry, clientele. And a lot of people were back and forth between Lafayette, New Orleans, Houston. I'd had one in Houston. And so it did very, very well and has always done well. And I think it's because people love to eat. And, of course, the oil industry is coming back now, and it's really, really been very, very busy.
Do you have a restaurant in Austin?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, the reason I asked is the greatest thing that happened to Ruth's Chris Steakhouse in Baton Rouge, outside of the food and the terrific management that you have there, I love both those guys, Kevin Kimball and Tommy Manson.
And Tommy.
The other thing that you have there is that legislature with all those lobbyists and with those big expense accounts, and that's why I asked you about Austin.
Baton Rouge does very well, much better than Austin does, because they're meeting all the time. In Austin, they meet once every 2 years.
Oh, my.
So they don't get a lot of business.
Get yourself a couple of good lobbyists to change the law.
Exactly.
Ruth, do you cook at all?
A bit, not too much anymore.
Were you a pretty good cook, though, yourself?
I thought I was a pretty good cook. I had all my mom's recipes, and she was wonderful.
Now, how about steak? Did you ever prepare steak at home?
No, but I sure did it after I went into business. In fact, every Monday, I was cooking from opening to closing, 11:30 to 11:30.
Oh, I didn't know that.
So
you did some of the cooking.
Also, not only did I do some of the cooking, I butchered for the first 5 years. So I did the butchering, I cooked, I did the book, I'd learned everything, I did everything. And to me, when you go into business, you better learn every aspect of it. Or
nothing would be more comforting than knowing, hey, particularly when you were starting out, if so-and-so doesn't show up today.
Yeah, I can do it.
I can do it. Absolutely.
I felt that was, I think it was a big thing in my success, being able to do it all.
When you went into the steak business, steakhouse business, were there any chain, was there any operation similar to that that served steaks and specialized?
You mean in New Orleans?
Any place. Was there a Ruth's
Chris? A chain? Yeah. No,
I don't think, not at that time.
No, I think I was the first one that really started with multiple units. Now, of course, there was Martin's and some steakhouses not serving prime meat like Sullivan's and Capital Grill and Outback. And
is there a difference in prime and the rest of the world?
Oh, you better believe there really is, yeah. The prime is so consistent, much more consistent than choice is. Choice is very good meat, but it's not, sometimes you'll get a great one and sometimes it is not so good. So it is not as consistent as prime meat.
That's the third time you've used that word consistent. That's really a very important
element. Yes, absolutely. Very, very important.
You know, it's interesting. We'll let human beings make errors, but we don't let restaurants make errors. We tend not to give another chance.
Yeah, that's
true. Ruth, you're a delightful lady who immediately told me, call me Ruth, and I want to thank you and tell you that you're really a Louisiana legend.
Oh, thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you for having me.
Of course.
Louisiana Legends is made possible by Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Louisiana. This important program series enables us to discover, through the accomplishments of our fellow Louisianians, the unique character of a state so proudly served by Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Louisiana for 60 years.
For a copy of this program, call 1-800-973-7246 or send 1995 to Louisiana Legends, care of LPB, 7733 Perkins Road, Baton Rouge, Louisiana, 70810. Please allow 4 to 6 weeks for delivery.